This is Ham Radio Now, episode 137, part 2. Once again from the Charlotte Ham Fest. Keeping up with our DX theme, this is going to be the Amsterdam Island 2014 Fox Tango 5 Zulu Mic DXpedition. Just wrapped up a couple of weeks ago as I record this. Our tour guide is going to be Bob Allphin, K4UEE. And once again, this is not going to be the video from the DXpedition, although there will be a video from this one. Bob has produced quite a few videos, and he'll be making one for this. It's probably not going to be out for a little while. So this is another slide presentation, but I think you'll find it very interesting, and we'll get to it in just a moment. But I need to have Arvin do our plug. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So if you enjoy the programs, get something out of them, stop by our website, hamradionow.tv. You can use a credit card or your PayPal account to make a contribution. We are looking for just $10 a year for all the content that we produce. We'd like to get that from a few more hams than we have. You have been very good to me and to the program. Those of you that have contributed, many have been very generous. And we have a pretty substantial number of contributors now, but we're way, way short of the 10,000 number that we're looking for. We get up a few thousand more, and I will be able to get back on the road and go farther than Charlotte, which is just down the road. I would like to be able to do that. For now, we're kind of stuck here in the palatial ARVN studios. All right, so let's head on down to the Charlotte Hamfest and the talk on the Amsterdam Island FT5 Zulu Mic DXpedition. I don't need to introduce Bob Allphin because the president of the CDXA, the Carolina DX Association, Hal Bolton, N4QT will give us some of Bob's credentials. So on down to Charlotte.
All right, let's talk a little bit about Bob. And this is just a brief background, because I'd be here all afternoon if I went through all of his accomplishments. FT5ZM, Amsterdam Island DXpedition, Bob Allphin. With the completion of this very successful DXpedition to Amsterdam Island, he's reached a milestone in his ham career. He's now participated or led or co-led DXpeditions to 10 of the DXC's top 10 most wanted DX locations in the world, which is just absolutely major. Since retiring 15 years ago to pursue DXpeditioning more or less full time, Bob's participated in 10 major DXpeditions that have made over 1.1 million QSOs. He has 9 DXpeditions of the Year plaques hanging on his wall. Bob is an active contester and has participated in 38 contest DXpeditions. From the mid-80s through the early 2000s, Bob set 5 operator single band world records and was a competitor in 2 world radio team championships, WRTC events, in 96 and 2000. Bob is a member of the CQ DX Hall of Fame, current chairman of Indexa, current president of the KP15, Bob, is that how you say that? Project, and former chairman of the ARRL DX Advisory Committee, DXAC. He's a member of the Voodoo Contest Group, First Class Operators Club, A1 Operators Club, and the Southeast DX Hall of Fame. He is a major DXer, and I am proud to present Bob Allphin to you right now. Let's give him a round of applause.
Thank you very much. You're probably, after hearing that rather impressive CV, bio, expecting a much older man. Actually, after this recent trip, I am a lot older. But, this is the first time I've presented this story. When I was invited to come, I said, you know, I'll just be back a few days. It turns out about 10 days. So this is the first time that I've put together a presentation to talk about our adventure. I started a week ago with 17,000 slides. The good news is I've narrowed it down to my favorite 5,000. And the even better news is there's no deadline on this meeting. So I figure, what? Sunset?
Tomorrow.
Or send out for dinner? Okay. Now, seriously. Pardon me?
I got 4 hours of tape.
4 hours of tape. Now, seriously, I don't know how this is going to go, and I don't know what I'm going to say, and I'm kind of looking forward to hearing what I say. I've picked out the best slides. I think they tell the story. I will tell you in advance that this story is not just about ham radio. It's a lot about the adventure. It's a lot about the travel, how we got there. It's about the island. It's a beautiful place. Really, really a beautiful place. And it's about the people that were our hosts on the island, because there were 20 French scientists or some military, 7 or 8 were military, the rest were there for scientific purposes. And of the 20 people on the island, 2 were dedicated to feeding them. They had a chef and they had a sous chef. So there was talk about whether people gained weight on Wake Island or not. After 9 days on the Braveheart getting to Amsterdam, we were well on our way to losing weight, but that all turned around when we started eating French food. We had, prior to lunch and prior to dinner, we had an assortment of cheeses and bread and wine available to us. Unfortunately, it wasn't for breakfast, but starting at lunch, and then, of course, another big meal in the evening and all of that, and usually at least 3 choices of desserts. So that's all part of the story. There will be some antennas. There will be some sunsets. There will be some people hunched over radios and all of that. But the real story, I think, is the adventure itself. So let's get started. Again, I'm anxious to see how this works out. It's a rare place. Why do you go there? Well, I go there because it's in the top 10. DX Magazine, edited by Carl and for AA, has it ranked number 4 last year. Club Log has it ranked number 7. The interesting point here is that 82.8% of the DXers in the Club Log database, which is quite large, needed a contact with Amsterdam for an all-time new one. Why is it so rare? Well, there's been 62 call signs issued since it became a DXCC entity in the early 50s. But the last activity was 15 years ago. How do you get there? Well, first thing you do is you figure out how to get 6 weeks and 6 days off. In my case, I'm retired, so that was the first hurdle. But then on the other hand, I've been married for 47 years, so there was a second hurdle. It's called a kitchen pass. And for the third time, I've gotten a 6-week kitchen pass. I left home on January 8th. I arrived in Fremantle via Perth. Fremantle's a subsidiary or a little town, little port right outside of Perth, Australia, in Western Australia. So I arrived on the 10th. The Braveheart arrived on the 12th. We departed the morning of the 14th. It took 9 days to get there. We were ashore 21 days, or 20 days as it turned out. 9 days back, we allowed built-in 4 days, and which we ended up spending at the island. We worked out very well in that regard, made a few more extra QSOs. Got back on the 23rd, and I was on an airplane on the night of the 24th to come home. Amsterdam is part of the French Antarctic Islands. You probably have heard of Kerguelen, FT5, what would it be anyway? Kerguelen, Crozet, which is right up there with Amsterdam, term the most needed. Also, Reunion Island. And also, there's a little island off of Reunion that doesn't count as a separate country. But in those French Antarctic Islands, there are 4 DXCC entities. So there it is. It's roughly halfway between Australia and South Africa. The way we went was 1,900 miles. And let me just put that in perspective for you. The boat goes 9 knots, or averages 9 knots. That's 10.3 miles an hour. So that trip from Fremantle to the island is like leaving Atlanta and driving to Denver, Colorado at 10 miles an hour.
Ouch.
Yes. Now, one of the challenges we faced here is that it's antipodal to southern Colorado. And most of the U.S. is, you know, you really don't know which way those signals are going to come from. For example, this is W3 and W4. That's W1, W2, to W6 and W0 over here. So we had monobanders. And part of the challenge was try to figure out which way to point them. And oftentimes, we had them pointed the wrong way, but we couldn't go move them because of the fur seals. Anything after dark, we were confined to our location. So there's Perth Air International Terminal. There's our beautiful hotel that was built in the 1890s. Nice place, yeah, very nice. And of course, here we are the first afternoon beginning that getting reacquainted process because most of these guys have been on trips together. I think there were three fellows in the group that I'd not traveled with before. And of course, dinner out, you could almost call this a before picture, I suppose. Not a lot of facial hair. and most of the guys, you know, look just like they did when they left home. Again, I mentioned that the Braveheart arrived on the 12th. So the crew came over and we had, you could tell the crew because of the long hair. Most of us had short hair, the crew had long hair. And we'll talk more about those guys later. But anyway, there was a lot of beer drunk that night. Nigel, who was the owner of the Braveheart, was not the captain on this trip, but he flew over and entertained us. And by that, I mean a lot of things. He's quite a storyteller. And he picked up the bar tab that night. It was $2,600. But beers are 11 bucks, so let's put it in perspective here. That's Nigel and his son. The guy on the right with all the hair, that's Matt. And Matt is 38 years old now and has been sailing with his father and now without his father for all those years.
In the red shirt.
Actually, right here. Brown shirt. Yeah, looks like a movie star, doesn't he? Handsome fella. The North Corridor DX group, which is the radio club in Perth, was a big part of this expedition. And VK6IR threw a party for us. This is the night we got there. And that's Steve, VK6IR, great guy. And one of the things that they provided us was 10 30-foot aluminum towers. So you'll see a lot of those. Now it's time to go. It's the morning of the 15th. There's the Braveheart. We're moving aboard. I want to point out some of these pictures that you're going to see here are rather spectacular. They were taken by EY8MM, no deer. And he is not a professional photographer, but a really good one. And some of these pictures literally will just knock you out of your chair. That's one of them. Look at, there's those tower sections and how they were stowed. This is probably my favorite picture and will be the picture on the Maritime Mobile card. Just some shots of the guys. Here's the custom folks coming aboard and checking all the passports and clearing us to leave Fremantle. The pilot was put aboard. The pilot is with Matt as he guides us out of the port, and then he leaves us, and we begin our nine-day voyage. Just some shots around. This is the way you get through 5,000 slides as you go kind of fast. That's our first sunset. This is taken from the bow looking back. And on the left there is Ralph Fedor, K0IR. Ralph is the guy, the organizer of the expedition and the leader. And I was the chief financial officer and fundraiser. And Ralph has got a pretty happy look on his face. It's all coming together for him. And I'm still thinking about how in the hell we're going to pay for it. Of course, anytime you get on a cruise ship, you have to have the mandatory drill, find out where the life preservers are. And this is one of the crewmen showing us how to get into one of the survival suits. These things are one size fit all. Of course, they picked the smallest guy to show you how easy it is to get into one of those. And that shows you what you look like if you want to survive. Of course, we've got to be on the air, right? That's one way you kill some time. There's no deer, probably one of the better shots of no deer. And we had a little KX3, one of those little brick amplifiers for it. So we were running 100 watts to that 14 AVQ. And I'm told we were pretty loud in this part of the country. In fact, Gary was telling me last night, if you're S9 on that vertical, you're probably going to be a little stronger with those monobanders and 500 watts or 1,000 watts. And we were, I understand. Here's Jorge. Now, I met Jorge a couple years ago. He was the guy who organized HK0NA and now has become a good friend. And I know who he's talking to. It's Monica. He has two Monicas in his life. He's got his wife and his daughter. They're both named, I guess it's one and two. And there I am talking to Mary. And some more shots. Isn't that a beautiful shot? This was one taken by no deer. So do you think no deer took that one? You bet. That is probably going to end up on my wall. I just think it's extraordinary. Again, another sunset, and there's one of the crewmen. I don't know where I've seen this before. Titanic, that's what it was. Now, that ship sunk. All right. You all have heard the name Braveheart for some time, I'm sure. It's been the vessel of choice for most of the Antarctic de-expeditions. But let me just show you what the Braveheart is and give you a little tour here. First of all, this is the library. And to the right there of Ralph is where the little station was set up just a few minutes ago. Here are three of the five DXpedition of the Year plaques hanging on the wall of the library, and hopefully there'll be another one soon after the Dayton Convention. Sure, I don't want to, well, that's what I'm hoping. And this is one of the two areas that we're moving aft from the library, and this is one of the dining areas. There's Ralph. Okay, now let's go downstairs. So there's three levels. We were on the main level, the library, the kitchen, the dining area, and there's dining area on either side of the hallway. So now we're going down to where we stay. And some people stay a lot. There's the stairs you just saw. So now I'm looking back the other way, and you've got little cabins. And by little, I mean little cabins on either side. This is the cabin that I shared with my good friend Steve, BE7CT. I had the top bunk, he had the bottom bunk, and you can see that our stuff is stored right there. This picture is out of order somehow. I don't know exactly where to put it. Let's go back to the tour. Now we're back upstairs on the main level. This is the kitchen, and this guy is an okay cook. Now on days like this is on the way now. It's pretty doggone calm, and we had a lovely meal. This is another meal another time, but everybody was just tickled to death. Probably a little wine being consumed. Everybody's got a thumbs up for that meal. And then there are days like this, and everybody's not so sure. I don't believe there's a smile in this group either, but at least there's six of the guys who decided to take their meal. And this is one of the crewmen. They all sat in the library and ate. This is Steve, and I guess when the cook eats his own cooking, it's a good sign. Okay, now we're going up to the top level. This is where the bridge is. And here we are on the bridge, Ralph and Matt and Odeer. And now this is the other side. Those chairs you saw are right here. That's the captain's chair, basically, and they're looking at some of the radio equipment there. And it's well-equipped. I mean, it's got all the modern types of communications gear and radars and weather faxes and a monitoring system. I was very impressed with this monitoring system of the engine. And here's the chief engineer. He's been with the boat 6 years.
How old is the boat?
30 years old.
30 years old?
Built in Japan. As a research vessel, and then Nigel bought it, I think, about 5 years after that, so it'll be what would that be, 89, 90, something like that. But look at that. I mean, that gives you some confidence that these people know what they're doing. That's a probably eat one of those great meals right off the top of one of those cylinder heads there. Well, there's only two of these on board. And this is the one that's inside the boat. The other one, you've got to go outside and you've got to contend with a big, heavy, waterproof door. So, I don't know what to say. I'm going to make a video. I've got eight of them now that I've done, and this is going to be, I've got some great footage. Here's the first mate. This is Billy. Billy's 53 years old, has a family, and is gone about, depending on the schedule of the boat, he's gone about half the year. Okay, we survived the 9 days. And this is the morning of the 9th day, and there's the island. And there's the French base. And obviously I did not rent a helicopter and fly up and take this picture. I got it off the web. But that does give you an idea. We were anchored right about here. And the Zodiac ran the trips back and forth here. There is no dock, so to speak, or a pier or anything like that. Just this big concrete thing here. So if you've got good weather and low waves, it's fairly easy. In fact, we experienced good conditions when we landed. It took 50 trips of the Zodiac back and forth to bring the stuff ashore, and then it would be picked out of the Zodiac. Here we are with one of those 50 trips, and then it would be picked up. He's, over here, he's going back for another load. Now the it looks like gas. And here's some of the French guys, the first time we got to meet them. And here's the base commander. Whoops, that's not the base commander. The base commander, the chief fireman, but more importantly, our bartender. And these guys were only modestly interested in what was going on. One of my favorite shots. We're looking at the Zodiac. There's
Mac,
yeah, front of the Zodiac. This is Elliot, and there's, I think that may be, that's probably half of our tower sections. Yeah. I'm bored. Don't stress me, though, because I bite.
Gasoline.
Thought that was a cute shot. Now we're bringing the folks aboard. In fact, that looks like Andy, UA3AB. That's me with my camera. Interestingly, when we departed some 20 days later, it was he and I ended up leaving the same Zodiac. And I sort of got a picture of that. Okay. Again, I've probably got some extra pictures here, but I want to try them out on you. There's some friends. There's one of the two ladies on the island. That's the doctor, and he is the, for lack of a better term, the park ranger. And now we're walking into the camp, and you'll see some of the things that we saw there.
What's the temperature?
Yeah. It's probably 55, 56. Not at this moment, but we did have some bad weather. I'll talk about that. This is probably where we, other than where we slept in a kind of a dormitory situation, this is the kitchen, the dining room, and the bar area. I thought it was a good sign when all the flags of the countries represented in our team were flying outside. Now, obviously, they didn't have on hand a flag from Tajikistan or Colombia. So they looked them up on the web, and they made one. That's a good sign, yeah. And again, moderate temperate weather, flowers, a lot of wildflowers, a lot of them were cultivated. So here's the base. There's two sites that we were assigned. Whoops. Mataf, which was a short walk. Let's see, I'm pushing the wrong button here. Short walk from the base. And then this, which was... When you measured that on Google Earth, it's about a mile and a quarter. But when you walk to it and follow the path, it's a lot longer. And you're climbing about 200 meters, 660 feet overall, so it's kind of flat, and then it goes up, and it's a pretty good hike, and we'll talk about that a little bit more. All right, let's start with Mataf. I was in charge of getting all the antennas up and the radios working and everybody on the air. And this is the path that we took from our sleeping quarters, which I don't have a picture of and need to add. And another no deer picture, which I, again, just fantastic. So they had trailers and little trucks that they used to take all the stuff from the wharf and to move it to the various locations. We had everything color-coded. So blue went to Mataf and red went to the other site, Antonelli. Oh, here we are digging out all the stuff. There's towers. We're getting ready. Got one antenna up. And these are how those towers are put together. They're very light. They're 10 feet long, aluminum, and they're put together with these things right here. So you could assemble a 30-foot tower in 12 minutes. And they were easy to put up because they were quite light. So we actually put the antenna on top, walked it up. I'm not sure. These were loaned to us by the VK6 fellows. Now, one of the requirements was is that if we had a fire or a spill or something like that, it had to be a method of containing it. So this is what the crew devised. These are actually fuel containers that were used up on the way over. And then they cut them out and made access to the generators that were put inside. The fuel was kept in a similar container and separate, probably 60, 80 feet away from where the generators were located. So now, again, I'm not sure which of these pictures is going to survive, but here we are, 10 meters, 12 meters, 15, 17, and 20, all lined up. That's probably a better picture, isn't it? All lined up and pointing roughly north because we found out we could split the difference between JA and Europe. Another shot.
These are all step IRs.
No, these are monobanders. And these monobanders at Mataf were made for us by Force 12. The ones at the other site were made by Cycle 24, which is a new company that I just saw was acquired by DX Engineering.
Do you use Armstrong rotators?
Pardon me?
Armstrong rotators?
Yes. We had tag lines tied to them. And we learned this, I guess, on Peter 1. This is a patch panel. So all the antennas come into the panel, and you can see that's the 17, that's the 20, that's the 30-meter antenna. And then these connectors on this side are tied to the four stations. So if you want to change from 20 to 17 and you're on station 2, you go out and you grab station 2's coax and you move from one antenna to the next. It's a good way to do it. Each one of these contained a complete station. K3, KPA 500, computer, everything you needed to set up a station. What here, we've got the 80-meter antenna at Mataf, and we're just finished putting it up, and we're coming down the hill. That's a basic configuration of the antennas that we used. I'm sorry, the radios that we used. At Mataf, we had two inside. This is to begin with, two inside and two outside on this picnic table. But we had some bad weather come through. We had a couple of guys get really cold, including me. So the next day, we moved one more inside. We still had this station that operated, you know, virtually 24 hours a day and outside. This is the inside looking in. You'll note there's some bunks there. I guess at some point, there's Steve, Jerry. I got two stories I want to tell. First of all, we were not allowed to travel at night because of the SEALs. They'd had one of their team get bitten and had to be evacuated, and I guess the word was that they were just undergoing their third surgery. So they're pretty dangerous, they have, I've been told that the only animal on Earth that has more bacteria in their mouth than a fur seal is a human being. So infection is a big problem. Anyway, that was one of the restrictions. So we couldn't do our typical 3 hours on, 6 hours off, or 4 hours on, 4 hours on, you know, which is very typical. So we had two shifts at Mataf, 12 hours each. You went in the morning at 6:30 and you came back at 6:30 at night. And you operated as long as you could and you went and laid down. So we had four people in there, we had four radios, and probably 2.5 of the radios would be manned at all times. Well, no, we probably, during the peak periods, we had them all manned. But mid-morning to midday, you know, some of the bands would go out, maybe you'd have one band that was open, everybody's going to sleep, because they knew the afternoon was going to be busy. That's story number one. At Antonelli, because of the hike, 24-hour shifts. You went up in the morning, four of you did. You operated all day, and then you tried to operate all night and come back the next morning. We modified it at the end. Actually, it wasn't a leadership decision. It was a decision made by the guys who were doing this. Why don't you guys go up in the morning and come back at sunset, and then I'll go up and I'll just work all night, and we'll get away from this 24-hour stuff. And that's kind of how we modified it. But again, this is a new approach. It was forced on us by conditions. And, you know, it worked. It worked. You'd operate 8 or 9 hours of the 12, and...
But you didn't know about the seal problem before you...
No, we didn't. We knew we could not travel overnight, but Mataf was so close that we didn't think there'd be a restriction here. Okay, now this is Jerry WB9Z. This guy is a animal on sideband. He made not the most, but probably the second most contacts. Now, I'm asleep inside in one of the beds, and of course, I'm not really asleep. I'm listening to Jerry run probably 250, 300 an hour. Bam, 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 bam. And suddenly, in the middle of that pileup, he says, "What kind of call is that?" And I sat up in my bed, and I started laughing, and I couldn't stop laughing. And it got funnier and funnier and funnier. Well, I asked him later, I said, "What happened?" He said, "I don't know, but it had too many numbers or too many letters. Or it just didn't sound like a call." And I didn't know what else to say except, "What kind of call is that?" So that'll be in the video because we recreated it later. All right, this is where we moved that outside station to. Here's N200 Bob, better known for his QSL manager prowess, but he lost 100 pounds and went on the trip with us. Made the most QSOs.
That's skinny.
Yeah, that's skinny Bob. Michelle, this is the guy that spent 9 days in the bunk. He's well rested when he got to the island. First thing he did was kiss the ground. Unfortunately, that's where some of the seals have been hanging out. And takes a little concentration to do this, right? There's Jerry again. Now notice how we've now boxed it in with the, because we had a front come through and it got cold, we got some rain, and you know we really weren't prepared for that. We had light jackets and that kind of thing. So. The night shift basically was out there with blankets over them. And I remember I was on that shift that night, and I was doing CW, and I always had to push my hand outside the blanket to get that call, and I put it back in again. It was so cold. So, you know, it was probably 45, but the wind was blowing, and, you know, that makes it. You know, probably know JK4ZLE. It's the only shirt he owns, by the way. Each of the sites had these propagation predictions. This was for 17 meters. And basically, we just used a 17 meter, we had one for each band, but not for each day. I mean, it was similar enough. So if I wanted to know what to expect on 17 meters at 0500, so this would be like 10 a.m. our time, this is pretty much it. And this is how we communicated. There's where I explained how the teams, there are three teams, night, 24 hours. Supper will be delivered to you, lunch, take a break and go get it. Sign up at the ping pong table at in our quarters there. Don't forget to use general frequencies. Oh, and don't forget, they called us the Teletubbies there on the Braveheart. That name has been since the first DXpedition. There's a lot of grass on the island. It was almost like Kansas and, you know, harvest time. And these guys were with you all night long. We did a demo for the 20 guys on the island. 19 showed up, and a bunch hung around afterwards. This guy on the right, this young man on the right here, is being introduced to some French hams, going to a club meeting. It just hit him. The magic of amateur radio hit him. It's really hard to get a flapping flag to stand out for you and at the same time have the vessel parallel to you. That's a bit, I took about 20 of these. That's the best one, believe it or not. More shots. Antonelli, hour and 15 minutes. We'll just round it off to an hour and 15 minutes. That's the path. That's a couple of guys taking one of several breaks. That's Bob on the left, by the way. Less is 100 pounds. That's what Antonelli looked like before. That's what it looked like after we had our way with it. Four stations. There's Erling, LA6VM, of Peter One fame, putting together antennas. And that's what it looks like. Now, we're up probably at about 700 feet elevation here. The ocean is out there, so it's not right on the ocean. We were much closer. I've got a lot of these pictures, and again, I don't know which ones are the best, but you get the idea. That's a no-deer picture. How do you like that? That's BA7DX operating. There's the same set of stations with different operators. All right, now Deere is a 160-meter enthusiast. Several of us are. But he actually knows a lot about antennas and propagation and stuff. I just call CQ and somebody answers. I say, BAM must be open to W2. So we took one of those 60-foot spider poles and we ran the wire up and out, which is what we've been using lately, an inverted L configuration. He tried that and was not satisfied. We ran a couple, and then we were off the air, off of 160, I think, for a night or two. We had six tower sections left over, and that 60-foot pole. So the bottom line is a 90-foot antenna with four top-loading wires. The crew, I'll talk more about the crew. They really, really became part of the team and did a lot of the heavy lifting. That's the matching unit. Oops. That's the matching unit, and I have no idea why those seals are there. Good shots. This should have been next. One of my favorite pictures, that's Ralph saying, whoa! Isn't that a great shot? Guess which one is the crew member and which one is it?
Did the antenna work?
Oh, yeah. 3,500 QSOs, 500 with North America. A lot of people. How many worked this on 160? Just one. Two. Where were you? Had a set of beverages in different directions. It really didn't work. I don't know what it was, and no deer never figured it out either. our best receiving antenna was the transmit antenna. It's probably because it's quiet. Another shot. These guys refueled all the generators every 6 hours. That was part of their job. They also had one crewman assigned to us for each 24-hour period. If you were at Antonelli, they brought the food up at night. They served you while you were operating. They made coffee for you. And they really did a good job. That's one reason the Braveheart is the vessel of choice. It's not the boat, necessarily. And one of the senior operators there. Yeah. Again, this is the matching network for the DX Engineering Foursquare. By the way, that antenna worked better than the beverages. And I've kind of got dibs on it when it comes home. We had 2-meter communication with Mataf. Let's explore the island. Now, I don't know what kind of penguin this is, but we're fortunate to have a penguin expert with us here in the audience today. So, Kay, would you mind telling us what kind of penguin this is? Well, it could be a macaroni. It could also be a rockhopper. It's very, yes. What is the difference, Kay? She's the expert. Well, we rehearsed this. We rehearsed this last night. Yeah, one hops and the other one crawls. I don't know. Now, I think this is a macaroni. The macaronis are about like this. The hoppers are about like that. But they
get stale, you know.
But they've all got the antennas. So they look pretty much the same. Thank you, Kay. I told you I wanted you here for a reason. Isn't that something? That's a pup. One of the things that the team was doing is counting, not our team, but the French guys were counting these, and they would mark them with paint after they counted them, because they move around. They're fur seal pups. And they counted 3,500 of them on the island. Yeah. Another no deer picture. This is the coastline near the camp. Some of the more fit guys got to take a trip, a 10-hour hike, if you will, to the top of the island, with the main caldera. That's looking down on the base. So we had a combination of guys from the French group, two or three team members, our team members, and a couple of guys from the Braveheart also.
So it's a volcanic island then?
Yes, yes. Now, if I had tried to do this, I would have been doing the same thing, but I'd be about 2 miles further back down the hill. And that's St. Paul. And it's 60 miles away, and they've never seen it before. That's what a great, clear day it turned out to be. How about that shot? How about that shot?
Is that your cook?
That's the cook.
Yeah.
Had fresh fish most days. And when we didn't, we had fresh blubber. No, not really. One of my favorite shots. That's the Kiwi flag, New Zealand flag. They were flying that on the main flag mast as a courtesy flag. The main French flag, tricolor, was here, but the courtesy flag is on the side. It's the way you do it on vessels as well. Life on the island, not too bad. If they managed to catch something, we had a barbecue. That's Eric, the leader on the island, a great guy, and he's trying to do the same thing at Crozet. What did you say? What? Must have a guy that needs Crozet in the back of the room.
I got a gal who needs Crozet in the front.
Okay. All right. Well, we'll see. This is Willie. Willie was one of the more fluent speakers of English and had a great sense of humor and was a lot of fun. and we saw a lot of him. Isn't that a great, great shot? And Willie had his own private bar, too. And we had a secret initiation there one night. I'm number four. Every meal, cheese, dessert, bread. Yep. Bob's gained back 50 of those 100 pounds he lost. Anyway, well, I'm going to show you some shots that no deer took at night. And if I recall correctly, these are like 5-minute exposures. And then the technique is to take a flashlight and highlight something for a few seconds or so. Well, this is one of those shots. Let me just, to get the full effect here. No, did not. But that you are looking at the Milky Way. I think there's one shot. Maybe it's got. I can't think. It's very common with Orion. He did not get one of the Southern Cross, which is I'm disappointed. That's something. Look at that. And what he's using now, a red light to highlight the grass, you see. Well, they threw a big party for us the night before we were to leave. They called it our departure dinner. And they had a special menu. Now, I don't know if they're really lobsters or not, but I would call them baby lobsters. I guess they're langostinos or something. But the first four meals, we had all the lobster we could eat. And then we got a little tired of it, believe it or not. But they had some left for the final dinner, and that was kind of like our appetizer. And then the main course was Bambi. Reindeer from Kerguelen. And then, of course, we had a huge Teletubbies departure cake. And then one last time, they opened the shopping center for 30 minutes so we could buy some mugs and stuff like that. This is that final dinner. And there's the cake.
Was that asparagus in the greens?
Uh-huh.
They grow it on the island?
No. I don't think they grow lettuce on the island. We had fresh salads. Maybe they grow the asparagus, but it was...
The Last Supper looked pretty good.
But how about that? Have a good trip home. Our little logo down there in the lower left-hand corner. Let's talk about the team. There's the guys, all 14 of us. There's Ralph, the expedition leader. There's the CFO feeling a little bit better about things because he's heard from home and there's some money coming in. Erling, LA6BM. K9CT. Whoops. Jay, K4ZLE in his other T-shirt. This is Arnie and 6HC. This is the first time I've been with Arnie. Arnie was our team doctor. And fortunately, we never needed him for his specialty. He's a urologist. Andy, UA3AB. WB9Z. Skinny Bob. Jorge. Neil, VA7DX, my friend Steve, Crazy Michelle, the 9-day wonder, and no deer.
Look at that picture. Oh, wow.
He looks like, the first time I met him was 2002. He looked like a movie star. Brad Pitt. Whoops. There's Billy. Elliot. And I can't think of his name right now. Good guy. Mission 65. This is the 65th group who has spent a year on the island. So they started in 49, I guess it was. So they call this Mission 65. And we had those shirts made up for them. And there's the TAF flag. TAF is the semi-governmental organization that is in charge of those Southern Ocean islands. About half the stuff was on the island. We'd taken down Antonelli the day before, and most of it got out. But this is the day the rest of it and the people were supposed to leave. I've got some excellent video of this until I got hit by a wave and the camera broke. But you can see that obviously there's just been a wave because it's draining off the concrete structure there. They have installed the ladder. It should be right about here. And you'll see in a moment. You've got two Frenchmen here. The idea is that our guy would back down the ladder. Matt would stay offshore until he saw some flat sets coming in. He'd come in and he'd drive the boat up against the ladder. You back down. And when they said, do it, you fell back into a bag. It worked. Now, we've been through this routine before on South Sandwich in 2002. I hope never to have to do it again, but there I am. And this is one of those white bags you saw earlier, and they stuffed it, so they made like a mattress. And it went well. You got everybody off? Now we're talking about the great haircuts that we just gotten that morning. In fact, one of the French soldiers was their barber, so we said, well, let's go ahead. It was free. Yeah. Saying goodbye to the island. Interesting shot with the cloud over there, over the top of the island. There we go. Far. Back to the hotel. Another Barbie with the Northern Corridor Radio Group, and the official name is the Neil Penfold Radio Center. Neil was, I think, BK6NC. If you've been around a while, you remember he was one of the more active BK6s. They've got their own station building and everything, and the guy sitting in the chair is Jorge. His home station is HK1NA, which is now could be the biggest contest station in South America. And this was Sunday night at sunset, and his station was on in the 160 contest. It's a phone contest. So he got the operator on Skype, had him at CW. And he's copying his station from Columbia. Now, the thing that's, it couldn't make a cue, but the thing that's significant about this is that on top band, there has been one QSO from Western Australia with South America. One QSO. So there will be a second QSO here if it hadn't already taken place. BK6HD and I think it was a PY they worked. Yeah. Yeah, I'm sure it was Mike. And these guys are all friends of Mike's, and, you know, he had just passed away several months ago. All right, so here we are at the club. This is the club president introducing us. Here we all sitting around. There's Ralph telling war stories. Let's wrap things up. Even I'm surprised that we made that many cues. Maybe there's something to be said for 24-hour shifts or something. As usual, more than half were with CW. That's because I tend to associate with those people and try to get them to go on the trip.
Interesting breakdown here. At least I thought it was. The you can't read it. The 14% on 17 meters, 15% on 12, 16% on 20, 17% on 15, 18%. I mean, that's pretty even spread, I think. I don't know the breakdown on phone and CW, but and then on you can see 40 and 80 and 160. 50% Europe, which is what you might imagine. North America, I think it's interesting. We worked so hard to work U that we actually made more Qs with U than we did with JAs. Now let's talk about this number again. The thing that makes this particularly impressive is that the nearest population center was 6,000 miles. Japan. The next nearest population center was 7,200 miles, Southern Europe. North America, where we made 25% of our Qs, the closest North American station was 11,000 miles away.
That's about
longer said. I know. So you look on there and see how far it said. They won't hear me. That's a long way. Okay, now for the bad news. That's the best guess right at this point. We got a little surprise with our final bill from TAF because they were charging us by the hour for those derricks and the trucks and the trailers and the operators of all those. But as you might imagine, the Braveheart was the biggest part of the cost. Our contract with the Braveheart was for $311,000. Here's where the money's going to come from. We're paying for about half of it, the 14 of us. Foundations, I'll show you in a minute, but that's kind of the breakdown. And this is old numbers, and we're farther along now, and I'll give you, at some point, I'll update all of this. We had estimated 100,000 Qs. That would be a cost of a little over $4 a Q. The good news is we got the cost down to $2.61. So, I mean, it's one way to look at this. Another way to look at it, 37,000 unique call signs in the log. Another measure. Our sincere thanks to our incredible sponsors. Let me suggest that maybe you thank them too. TAF, certainly. Ellicraft. Thanks, Ellicraft. Thanks, Array Solutions. These are the no OM amplifiers made in Slovakia. These are OM 2000s, and they just cranked along at full power for 20 days, 18 days. We want to thank DX Engineering, Force 12, and Cycle 24 for the monobanders and the verticals and the beverages. We want to thank Northern California DX Foundation for $50,000, second largest grant they've ever made. I want to thank Indexa for $10,000, which I believe we were talking last night, that may be the second largest grant ever made, the largest being to Peter One. I want to thank the ARRL Colvin Award for $5,000. We want to thank JA1ELY and 5.9 Magazine for $5,000. We want to thank the German DX Foundation for $5,000. And by the way, there are so many Germans in the log, they got their money's worth. I want to thank some other people, too. I want to thank these folks right down here. Carolina DX Association, $1,500. All of these people, the first five here gave us $2,000. The rest, at least 1,000. And I think that means the end. Wow. I couldn't be more surprised at what time it is. So I could probably add some slides for the next one, right? I assume we've got some time for questions. Let's do that right now, and then I've got a final comment or two.
Over here.
How long from the concept to the first day of execution?
2 years.
The original contact was made on Reunion Island with the local office of TAF there by an FR5, a Reunion Islander who we had met in 1997 on our way to Heard Island. And he walked in and told what we were talking about and then emailed us back and said,
it went pretty well. And it did. It continued on. And I think after a pretty good show, certainly the French people on the island enjoyed our company and would recommend us as a professional group of amateurs. So we're just debating right now where we want to, what we want to do next. Good question. Yes.
Scientists studying. You may have mentioned that.
What was it? What?
What were the scientists on the island studying
primarily? Good question. 7 or 8 were military. The rest had various scientific they weren't necessarily scientists, but they had scientific missions. One of the big things they were doing is studying global warming and pollution. And I've got a video interview with Eric, the base commander, and he talks about that. And I said, well, look, I don't want to get into any political discussion here, but what's the evidence? And he said, well, first of all, understand that this is probably one of the most pristine places on the planet. I mean, we are thousands of miles from anywhere else. So if we're measuring an increase in this or that or pollution or this or that, then probably something's going on. And he said, and we are. So there was 2 people devoted to studying the sun. I mean, they knew all about the sunspots and everything and showed us printouts of all the things they're measuring. They also showed us where we were interfering with one of those devices. And about halfway through the expedition, we had to shut down on 80 and 40 from Metaf. Yeah, we weren't going to argue with them. We just said, shut down. Yes. He's asking about the signal levels. The strongest signals from North America were on 20 meters. I mean signals 20 over 9. It'd be in our morning, your evening, and vice versa.
What about 40?
I probably saw. I worked a friend of mine in Texas, NA5U, who's treasurer, secretary of the KP15 project. He's got a new two-element stepper, I think, of 40. He's got 2 elements on 40 at 55 feet, and he was S9 on 40 sideband. On 80, there's always somebody that's S9, but most of the signals would have been less than that, but workable. When I worked myself on 80 CW, I know you're wondering how that works. I was S5. On 160, we were working signals anywhere from S half to probably some of the Europeans were over 9. If you are on an expedition and someone goes to your house and uses your station to work you, it counts. So W6IZT was at my station. I just want to clear that up. I mean, we do have K here. And she says it's okay. Yes, Gary?
Bob, one of the comments that was made during the expedition, or just at the beginning, from WB9Z was that this was the hardest expedition he had ever been on. And then there was another little line after that. It was because of the grants.
Because of the what?
The grants.
I rather than go back and show you the slides, it was particularly a problem at Antonelli. Because that shack, that cabin, was perched right on the edge of a caldera. And I should find pictures of that. The grass growing was, some of it was this high. And you're right on this peak, so you walk into the grass here, and that grass could be concealing a hole between two pieces of lava. And he fell a couple of times. That's probably why he mentioned that. But all of those antennas had to be assembled and then erected and guide in that grass that was maybe this high. And you couldn't see, you know, ground.
Well, I knew he had been on some tough expeditions, I wasn't sure what.
Well, the other thing was that was probably early in the expedition, and Jerry was one of the guys who built Antonelli, so he was up there every day for 3 or 4 days, and it probably, you know, quite tired.
A lot of water, dude.
Yeah. You have a question, John?
What number on the DFFC was that? Are you
DXFC, Foot Countries, that was Foot Country 121. Yeah. All that time and all that travel, I got one. Okay, any other questions then? Yeah. We made 5,600 queues from the boat, and we got a special QSL card.
I never thought to send it to anybody. Who's Bob?
Yeah, Bob's doing it, and you can do it OQRS. Bill?
What is the KT thing you referred to? What is you referred to KT something?
KP15
Project. That's a group that was formed in 02 trying to get access to Desecheo and Navassa, and we're halfway there. Desecheo is done. So, surprised that hadn't come up. We're working on it, okay? We're working on it. I just want to follow up with a couple of personal comments, if I might. Kay mentioned this in her presentation today, and do you have the little envelope, Kay? Have you seen this in your mailbox if you're an ARRL member? If you haven't, you probably will soon. There's a letter in there from K5RQ, who is the chairman of the committee that I'm on that's trying to add money for the second century to the endowment. And it's if you'll read it, I think it'll probably hit you between the eyes. And by that, I mean it asks you to take a few minutes and think about amateur radio and what amateur radio has meant to you. Kay, in her talk today, asked how many people's careers have been affected by amateur radio, and a lot of hands went up. But everybody has relationships and friendships and experiences because of this great hobby. So instead of writing a check for $50 and saying I've done my part, spend a few minutes thinking about the last, in my case, 55 years and how my life would have been different without this hobby. And I wrote a lot bigger check than that, and I think you will too. So just do that, please. And we're trying to raise $10 million. We've got $6.1 million. We'd love at the ARRL convention this summer to announce that we are at our goal. So I'll leave it at that. Any support is appreciated. Don't misunderstand me. $50 is appreciated. But people have different resources. Some of you may decide, you know, I can do more than that. And you can spread it out over 3 to 5 years, in some cases 10. There's lots of ways to do it. Appreciated stock. Cash is always welcome. I don't think we take credit cards. But think about maybe putting the league in your will, for example. That's another way to do it. You can do a dollar amount or a percentage or something like that, or some combination of all of those. I want to thank you for the invitation to come here. It forced me to get my first PowerPoint presentation put together. I've got good friends here. I'm sorry Mary's not here to be with her good friends as well. Again, you've got a great clubs in this area, great people, and I hope that sometime I will risk my life again to earn an invitation to speak here. Thank you very much.